Thank you. to be in a room where everybody's really listening intently, and I kind of feel the vibe of that. Was there anything that you didn't expect? Was there anything that's kind of surprising? Like, yes.
I didn't expect the bass to do what it was doing at the A section.
Why not?
Because I thought you would start with laying down half notes or doing do 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 do.
Right, which you ended up doing later.
Yeah, but you started out really single.
Yeah, it's pretty loose. Uh-huh. Yeah, I mean, it's interesting because like I've played this tune probably a million times, you know, and this is one of those tunes that it starts to get pretty far away from the original version because people are trying to do different things with it. And then when you listen to, I hate to say a pure version, but kind of like the tune at its inception, you know, I mean, who knows when, how long of a period there was before Joe Henderson wrote this tune and they played it. He could have written it 10 minutes before, or he could have written it a couple days before, probably something like that. As opposed to now, where it's like, this is a tune that everybody plays, and, you know, I'm sure there's been a million different versions, you know, and I'm sure every time Joe Henderson played it, there was something different about it, you know. But, yeah, I think this, what surprised me was the rhythmic feel. We think of this as a Latin tune, and this is kind of like what I like to call jazz musicians interpreting Latin, or interpreting like a samba groove, you know, and it's really not so much like, it's very subtle, it has a little bit of a swing to it. You know what I mean? It's not like if you had a bunch of Brazilian cats playing it, it'd be quite different, I think. You know? It's kind of like a jazz samba-ish, you know? If you've ever heard the Art Blakey record called Free For All, there's a song in there called Pensativa. And that's got it's a little bit more obvious, but it's kind of, it's not just straight Latin, you know what I mean? It's got a little bit of that lilt to it, you know? And it would only make sense because Pete LaRocca is a jazz, you know, he's a jazz drummer, so it makes sense he'd have that. And I think the same with the bass. It's like, it's not so much like, oh, I have to play Latin. It's like, it's a little bit of a mixture. You know what I mean? I actually played some gigs with that bass player later, and he's still alive. Butch Warren.
He was
Warren.
That.
Huh?
He was that.
Butch Warren. Yeah, he was sort of, everyone who talks about him says that in this era, he was poised to be what Ron Carter is today. But he had some problems. who was playing piano? Anybody know?
Tommy Dorsey.
Who?
It wasn't Tommy Dorsey.
Tommy Dorsey on piano. No. I don't think so. It was McCoy Tyner. And that kind of surprised me because we tend to associate, this is McCoy Tyner when he was very young. And so we tend to associate him with, you know, how he played with John Coltrane, very heavy. This was pretty light, you know, especially in the beginning. It's kind of, you can tell the voicings are McCoy Tyner, but it's a little bit more floaty than I remembered, you know. Anything else? Yeah.
I thought, sort of given the head, I expected the trumpet solo to come out of the box just you know, furious and going at it. Instead, it was simple and pure and almost plaintive.
Mm-hmm.
Who is the trumpet player here?
It's Kenny Dorham.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh.
Yeah, who's kind of known for, I mean, there's a certain relaxed intensity to how he plays, you know, and certainly he's got a beautiful range, like, I think Kenny Dorham is another one of those players that's, like, severely underrated, you know, it's like if you went down the list of trumpet players you had to talk about, you know, you'd have to talk about Freddie Hubbard, you'd have to talk about Louis Armstrong, you'd have to talk about Dizzy Gillespie, you'd have to talk about Miles Davis. You'd have to talk about Freddie Hubbard. You'd have to, at least for me, you'd have to talk about Woody Shaw. Where does Kenny Dorham fit in that? He tends to get left out, you know. But beautiful player, you know. And he and Joe Henderson played a lot together. And you can, one. And this is another thing that, if you were to listen to it again, is just the way they phrase the melody together. And that's something that I did not put in the chart at all, is the articulations, you know. They have a very specific way of articulating it, you know. I think we could find our own way to articulate it, but you know, the first few notes are ba 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 ba, you know, and then it's kind of a mixture after that. Is there another comment? Yes.
I noticed drums and bass are incredibly consistent
the whole piece, they kept, the time was so strong, it never wavered at all.
I'll buy that. But even within that, like my man was saying, like the bass had a certain looseness rhythmically, but in terms of the overall groove, yes, it was really consistent.
In that case, I think they were improvising around a consistent figure.
Clavin.
Yeah.
It was a room with Clavin.
Right. And they were improvising around it while keeping it perfectly consistent, never wavering from the time. And sometimes I think that's like what I have trouble with, is keeping the time super strong, always.
Well, practice with the metronome?
Yeah, I mean...
That might be something that Daryl would want to deal with in his lecture about practicing. And I think that's something that is... Hopefully that we'll all get a chance to deal with, you know, when we coach the ensemble or whatever. But to me, what makes jazz distinct is rhythm. It's a rhythmic language, but I think having consistent time is one of the most important things we can do as jazz musicians. You know, I think that you could be deficient in a lot of areas, but if you have good time, you will be more successful.